528. Elros and Elrond, twin sons of Arendil, born. This was later changed to the year 532. The Lord of the Rings and the Silmarillion do not state anywhere that Elrond and Elros are twins, yet they are probably the most famous twins in the Legendarium. The appendices state that they are the sons of Arendil, and the Silmarillion states that they are brothers. The passage I quoted from the History of Middle-earth seems to settle the matter, with the year of their birth changed from the year 528 of the First Age to the year 532. Isn't it strange that the only mention of them being twins is found in such an obscure place? This video will explain why this is, and will show that it is quite possible that these very important figures are only twins because of an error found in The Hobbit. While both figures are probably well known to anyone watching this video, let's give a very brief overview of each character. Elrond is the master of Rivendell. He was raised at the havens of Sirion, later dwelling in Lindon before founding Rivendell. There he remained until the end of the Third Age, when he departed over the sea. He was a prominent figure in both the Second Age and Third Age, a member of the White Council alongside Galadriel, Gandalf and others, bearer of a great ring of power, Vilya, and guardian of Aragorn, who he raised throughout his childhood in Rivendell, until he came of age and was told of his lineage. Elros, being the twin brother of Elrond, shares much of his early history. The brothers are the children of Arendil and Elwing, and the grandchildren of Tuor and Idril. Like their parents, Elros and Elrond were given the choice to accept the gift of men, or be counted among the elves, as they were descendants of both elves and men. Elrond made his choice and was counted among the firstborn, the elves. Elros accepted the gift of men and was counted as a mortal among the secondborn. He later became known as Tar Minyatur, the first king of Numenor, ruling the Isle for 410 years before dying at the age of 500. Now, if we look at the history of Tolkien's writings, there is a draft dated from 1925 to 1926, in what is called the Earliest Silmarillion. Here Elrond is described as being bound by his mortal half, electing to stay in Middle-earth instead of returning west with the elves. We are told that through him, the blood of Húrin and of the elves is now found among men. Their son, Elrond, who is half mortal and half elfin, a child, was saved, however, by Mithros. When later the elves return to the west, bound by his mortal half, he elects to stay on earth. Through him, the blood of Húrin, his great uncle, and of the elves, is yet among men, and is seen in valour, and in beauty, and in poetry. Tolkien carried this idea forward to the fall of Numenor, in writings dated around 1936. It is here that Elrond is described as the one who was the Lord of Numenor, not Elros. Tolkien says that Elrond was the one who built it, and was the result of the mingling of the houses of Hador and Beor, two of the three houses of the Edain, known as the Elf Friends of the Elder Days. At this stage of development, Elrond is described as a mortal and occupies the place in the Legendarium that we understand now as belonging to Elros. It was built first by Elrond, son of Arendil, whom the gods and elves chose to be the lord of that land, for in him the blood of the houses of Hador and Beor was mingled, and with it some part of that of the Eldar and Valar, which he drew from Idril and from Lúthien. But Elrond and all his folk were mortal, for the Valar may not withdraw the gift of death, which cometh to men from Ilúvatar. It wasn't until later text, where Elrond was said to be Elrond Half-elven, one who chose and was granted a position among the Elf kindred, and the Elrond of Númenor becoming Elros. Tolkien describes in letter 257 the fortunate accident to have Elrond become the Half-elven of the mythology. What was the reason? It was the difficulty in inventing good names for characters that were being introduced. Tolkien casually gave him the name Elrond, but as it came from the mythology that had already been established, he was made half-elven. From the Hobbit are also derived the matter of the dwarves, Durin, their prime ancestor, and Moria, and Elrond. The passage in chapter 3 relating him to the half-elven of the mythology was a fortunate accident. Due to the difficulty of constantly inventing good names for new characters, I gave him the name Elrond casually, but as this came from the mythology, Elros and Elrond, the two sons of Arendil, I made him half-elven. Only in the Lord was he identified with the son of Arendil, and so the great-grandson of Lúthien and Beren, a great power and a ringholder. This difficulty in naming characters and having them not share names is not limited to the figure of Elrond. Legolas is an elf of the woodland realm who becomes a member of the Company of the Ring. Anyone who has any experience with the Lord of the Rings will know of Legolas, son of Thranduil, and a great friend to the dwarf Gimli. What about Legolas of Gondolin? A minor character in early versions of the Legendarium, found in the Book of Lost Tales, a scout belonging to the House of the Tree. This isn't the same elf, but Tolkien's problem comes from this idea that elves do not reuse names. The most famous example is Glorfindel. An elf named Glorfindel exists as a noble elf of Gondolin, who fled the city and fought with a Balrog to help Tuor and Idril escape. As with Legolas, there is a Glorfindel in the Lord of the Rings, the elf who helps Aragorn and the hobbits reach Rivendell when pursued by the Ringwraiths. Are these the same Glorfindel? Despite people debating this, the matter was apparently settled by Tolkien with a major change to the mythology, having Glorfindel be an elf who was re-embodied and sent back to Middle-earth as an emissary of the Valar. Also very notable is Glorfindel tells of his ancestry in Gondolin. Years later, long after the publication of The Lord of the Rings, my father gave a great deal of thought to the matter of Glorfindel, and at that time he wrote, "The use of Glorfindel in The Lord of the Rings is one of the cases of the somewhat random use of the names found in the older legends, now referred to as the Silmarillion, which escaped reconsideration in the final published form of The Lord of the Rings." He came to the conclusion that Glorfindel of Gondolin, who fell to his death in combat with a Balrog after the sack of the city, and Glorfindel of Rivendell were one and the same. He was released from Mandos and returned to Middle-earth in the Second Age. Tolkien found himself in a similar situation with Elrond. The Hobbit gives us a very strange account of Elrond that doesn't quite fit with the figure we find in The Lord of the Rings, with the latter having Elrond be a noble elf, one of great wisdom, insight, and foresight, an elf lord of note, great among the great. In The Hobbit, Elrond is described to us as if he is not an elf, despite Tolkien saying that he had already made him one of the half-elven. The master of the house was an elf friend, one of those people whose fathers came into the strange stories before the beginning of history, the wars of the evil goblins and the elves and the first men in the north. In those days of our tale, there were still some people who had both elves and heroes of the north for ancestors, and Elrond, the master of the house, was their chief. He was as noble and as fair in face as an elf lord, as strong as a warrior, as wise as a wizard, as venerable as a king of dwarves, and as kind as summer. Let's look at this description of Elrond. He is apparently an elf friend, those people whose fathers came into strange stories before the beginning of history. Elves aren't really described as elf friends elsewhere. Elrond himself even says in The Lord of the Rings that Frodo's courage and sacrifice in volunteering to carry the One Ring to the Mountain of Fire would have him share a seat among them. Throughout history, the term elf friend has been given to very notable figures, with men Hador, Beren, Húrin, Túrin, Aragorn, and Elendil. Among the hobbits, Bilbo and Frodo Baggins. Gimli the dwarf is also an elf friend. Of elves, only Elrond is described as an elf friend. It makes little sense to call an elf friend, especially one who long ago made his choice and was counted among them. In the same quote, he is described as fair in face as an elf lord. Obviously, an elf lord can be described as having characteristics expected of one, but the rest of the quote shows us that Elrond is being described as things he isn't: a warrior, a wizard, a king of dwarves. Still, it does describe him as descending from both elves and men. This description of Elrond always seemed a little more man than elf to me. This could just be a consequence of the writing style of The Hobbit, with changes made later, before The Lord of the Rings. I get this same feeling from Gandalf, who feels like a different character to me in both novels. But returning to Elros, it means that he was introduced to take the place of Elrond, with this Elrond in The Hobbit becoming a part of the wider mythology, leading to the figure we find in The Lord of the Rings being the twin brother of the first king of Numenor. Elros was essentially what Elrond had been before, and Tolkien's solution was to make them twin brothers. Tolkien found this easier than explaining that this Elrond was a different Elrond than the first king of Numenor. This fortunate accident, as Tolkien calls it, has led to one of the most interesting family trees in the entire Legendarium. It has led to notions of destiny, with Aragorn descending from Elros through the kings of Numenor, lords of Andúniel, Elendil, kings of Arnor, kings of Gondor, and the chieftains of the Dúnedain, to wed Arwen, daughter of Elrond. The most famous of twins in the Legendarium may have been very different figures had Tolkien not reused one name. If you liked this video, then please consider subscribing to support the channel, and I hope you'll be back for my next video.